Hello dudes, welcome to part two of this video on pigment making. In part one, I created pigment powder out of spinach, lavender, mint leaves, pickled beets, a strawberry slash raspberry mixture, and black currants. If you missed that video, feel free to click on the link in the description. In part two of this series, I worked with ingredients that I thought would be more likely to create vibrant colors. In a video about lake pigments uploaded by Nada Makes, link in the description by the way, she mentions that adding lemon changes the color of the pigments. If you're curious as to why this happens, the only explanation I can offer is something acidity. So I took some of the liquid pigment from the beets and cabbage and separated them into different jars. This way, I could test the difference between colors with and without lemon added. This is all of the dye stuff. It's quite a big bowl. And obviously I made a mess. So here are all of my colors. I have my red cabbage divided into two jars here. This is the red onion, and then my beets, also divided into two jars. And what I'm gonna do, since I have two jars of this and two of this, I'm gonna add lemon to these two here, just to see how it'll change the colors, how and if it'll change the colors. So yes, a first step is to take our aluminum sulfate, or alum, which is potassium aluminum sulfate, but I'm just using regular aluminum sulfate. So I'm gonna heat up some water, dissolve the alum, and divvy it up into these jars here, and then I'll add a few scoops of the washing soda. So this is my pot of alum dissolved in water. So in this case, I dissolved 4 tablespoons of aluminum sulfate in 3 cups of water, so I'm gonna pour 1/2 cup into each of these. And obviously I ended up with different amounts for each because I didn't measure precisely this time. So yeah, I don't know what you wanna do with these measurements. They're not exactly, I don't know, I guess accurate. So yeah, I'm just kind of winging it. This is the red cabbage. I'm just gonna dip a tissue in so you can, just so you can see. It's a nice purple color. And yeah, it'll be the same over here. Well, I have slightly different proportions, but yep, it looks similar. So let's see what happens when we add, here, let me reposition my camera. See what happens when we add a little bit of lemon. It looks the same. I don't know if that did anything. Oh, actually, it changed it to like a warmer purple. So this here, this is this one here, the original. And that's kind of cool. I have my washing soda here, and the recipe that I looked at said to put 2 parts alum, 1 part washing soda. Some recipes say I need to dissolve the washing soda, but like I said, that sort of ended in disaster, so we're gonna avoid that. And I'm just gonna divvy this up here. This is 2 tablespoons. I'm gonna divvy it up between these here. Ooh. Oh, cool. You can see like hints of blue. That's kind of interesting. Let's see what this one will look like.
Oh no, it's happening. I decided to give it a stir and now it's all bubbling up. Oh shoot, this is what happened last time. I don't know what to do. I don't know if I should put on the lid or would that make things worse? I don't know. I'm just gonna do it. Sorry. I hope this doesn't end badly. I don't know what to do. Like, should I mix the other ones or would that just be bad news? I don't know. Okay, so my kitchen's a mess. This one didn't flow over, but this one ended up just overspilling. Of course, I ended up mixing all of them because I'm a child. I couldn't resist. I don't see too much of a difference between these two, but like it's interesting that there are hints of blue here, and I really, really, really hope that one of these ends up being a nice blue or teal color. That would be so cool.
In the next batch, I boiled carrots, turmeric, and paprika. The filter I used to separate the spices from the liquid didn't work very well. I used this metallic tea/coffee filter, and some of both the turmeric and paprika clearly made it through. So in these cases, my end result was a combination of washing soda and kitchen spices. The carrots didn't release any color at all, so I ended up having overboiled carrots for lunch that day. Needless to say, I was only able to eat half of them.
Hey guys, this is, I think, almost a week later. I just let them sit in the jars. Usually you could just let them sit overnight as long as you see the sediment at the bottom. This here is red cabbage with the lemon, and I actually went back in just to experiment and added a bit more washing soda, and it kind of bleached it out a bit, but it also made it more green, so that's kind of interesting. Just by looking at the sediment, I'm not expecting a really bold color, but you know, I guess we'll see what happens. So I'm just gonna take this guy here and I'm gonna pull out the water. I'm not really gonna film this part because I'm gonna take this to my washroom, but just so you guys could see. Yeah, look at that water. So I'm gonna take this, dump it out in my sink, and then I'm gonna replace the water, and I'm gonna keep doing this until the water is clear, and you wanna take out as much water as you could without removing the sediment.
Final day came to filter out all of my precious pigments. This was my setup. I have a ton of miscellaneous jars, coffee filters, and bowls. This time I tried not to make a mess. Emphasis on tried. I definitely made a mess. What I did first is remove some of the clear water sitting on top of the pigment so that it would filter through more quickly. I then set out my coffee filter and poured like there was no tomorrow. The paprika and turmeric were looking some type of way. By the way, until this voiceover, I thought it was pronounced turmeric, not turmeric. And throughout this video, I've been saying turmeric. So I'm sorry, force of habit. Once all of my pigments were filtered, I sat them down on a baking rack. This stage is always interesting, and I'm sure that my family was kind of confused as to what all of these substances in coffee filters were. My brother accused me of things that I do not appreciate. Based on the first attempt, I knew that the colors would likely be different upon drying. And through this, I also knew not to be too hopeful.
This here is beets plus lemon. This one here is just the beets, so it was like this really nice, rich pink color, but of course it dried a lot lighter. This one here, red cabbage, yes. Red cabbage, which is a nice medium blue color. And I already have like a dark blue, so we got that covered. And this was actually red cabbage plus lemon. So as you can see, completely bleached out. Do not add lemon if you do this. It kind of changes the color at first, but then yeah, it just doesn't end well. You know what? I'm a little confused. Let me see. So, beets, red cabbage. No, you know what? I lied. This one here is actually the red cabbage plus lemon. So it did bleach it a little bit, but you could still see like it's a light blue color. So I'm gonna see if I could salvage this. And this one here was actually red onion. So yes, red onion did not work out. but yeah, that's fine. That's the whole point of this experiment. We have some turmeric here.
So I don't know if you could tell, but it's super grainy. And I'm pretty sure some turmeric escaped my first filter and it just dried up with the washing soda. So I'm sure there's turmeric in here. And if I smell it, it actually does not smell like turmeric, which I'm kind of surprised. Yeah, it doesn't smell like turmeric. It did for a while, even while it was drying. That smelt a little bit of turmeric. So I'm glad that it seems to have lost that scent because I don't want my paints to smell funky. Yeah, I made paper. So I had made con paper and that smelled really funky. So if you want to watch that video, I'll link it down below. But yeah, I don't want a repeat of like smelly art materials. And this here is paprika. So it dried quite a bit. There's not a lot of sediment left. And as you can see, here is more noticeable than in the turmeric. You can see a lot of grainy particles here. So I'm pretty sure that there's some actual paprika mixed in this. But it's fine because look at how it stained the filter. Like, look at this. Like, if you look at this one here, it didn't really stain it. And like all of this is like powder that comes off. So hopefully it makes a good paint because that's the whole point of this. Like that's all I'm trying to achieve here. I just want to make paints that work. So we're going to go ahead and grind these up. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we'll see how it looks.
The fun part is grinding up all of the colors. Mostly because this stage is when you really see your pigment powder become pigment powder. You know the color you have after the pigment dries is generally what you're going to walk out with. I won't lie, it was satisfying to see all of my pretty colors sitting in those little containers.
I got a mask and some glasses to protect myself from whatever this is, all this smoke or dust, just because it's probably a bad idea to be breathing this stuff in.
Finally came the day to actually turn the pigments into paints. In order to do this, I needed a watercolor binder. So I used a combination of earth pigments and Arlia Bean's recipe for watercolor binder, both of which are linked below. Generally, the breakdown is 2 parts water to 1 part gum arabic to 1/2 part of a glycerin/honey mixture. Then a few drops of some sort of preservant. In this case, I use clove oil as per Arlia Bean's recipe. I also use boiled water so the gum arabic would dissolve nicely. The gum arabic, by the way, I purchased via Amazon, and I'll link all of the materials down below. Okay guys, I'll be honest with you, this DIY pigment thing is like a 30-step process. It's kind of exhausting and also involves a ton of random materials that I wouldn't say I'd recommend investing in. In order to mull watercolors, you need a binder and a mulling set. Mulling sets are actually very expensive. Me being a total DIYer / cheap ass, I improvised. Buying a $5 candle holder with a completely flat base from Michaels, and of course I used a coupon, so it was actually $3.50. I sanded down a handle of a wooden toilet plunger and gorilla glued it on. Following this, I took an old tile from my dad's shed and sanded the surface down to become more effective at incorporating the pigment into the binder. Once again, this was an Arlia Bean tip. Which, by the way, was my inspiration for going through this whole entire process to begin with. So if you haven't checked out her pigment mulling videos, I highly, highly recommend them. Make yourself a cup of tea, fix yourself a snack, and just watch or draw or do both because it's really entertaining and also kind of calming. This was my fabulous homemade $3.50 setup. And you know what? I kind of love it. Toilet plunger and all. The first color I decided to mull was the pigment powder from the red cabbage. It formed a really nice blue hue. Now, normally people mull their watercolors for quite a while, 30 minutes minimum, about an hour or over an hour max. I opted for 20 minutes, and that's a very generous estimate. Like I said, my patience is quite limited. I tested the color on a blank page of my sketchbook just to gauge how much pigment versus binder to use. And from there, I sort of played it by ear. Next, I worked with the beets. At this point, it was getting late, so sorry about the bad lighting. This color turned out quite lovely, or nicer than expected at least. I was hopeful that my paints would turn out somewhat decent. Normally, when mulling paints, people use a palette knife set. All I had was a plastic palette knife, but I was actually quite thankful for it. Because it was plastic, it was quite flexible, which actually helped with scraping off the bit of paint I was able to make. Following the beets was the strawberry pigment powder, which turned into a nice purple. But this one didn't end up as pigmented as I hoped. Overall, this project was very time-consuming. If this is something you'd like to attempt, then know that it'll take a good amount of experimentation. I was happy to walk out with a small handful of paints that I could actually use in my artwork. And of course, there's a certain amount of pride involved in harvesting and creating your own pigments. It's truly a labor of love. And as someone with very little love to spare, I don't think I would do this again. Not anytime soon, at least. Luckily, the aluminum sulfate had some use in sizing my handmade watercolor paper, so my materials weren't a total waste. And I actually used the binder I made to create watercolors out of grinded up chalk pastels. Videos of both are in post-production, by the way, so coming soon. I don't regret taking on this project, especially since lake pigments are kind of mysterious. And I hope that this video inspires a small handful of you to experiment with this creation process. But the most important thing I want you to walk away with from this video, for anyone thinking about creating your own pigments at least, is to make do with what you have. Because being creative is not only inherent in the art you make, but in your setup as well. Not being able to afford a mulling set or not being willing to drop a couple hundred dollars on one did not stop me from making my own paints. Work with what you have as much as possible and you might just surprise yourself with the results. I truly hope you enjoyed this video. It was easily the most time-consuming video I've created in terms of both filming and editing, hence why I procrastinated for so long before diving into this project file. If you know anyone who would find this video interesting, I hope that you share it with them. Subscribe, like, unsubscribe, dislike, free will and all. But seriously, if you're interested in an amateur artist doing art things while talking about the novelty of life and creativity, then it might be worthwhile to stick around for a bit. Until next time, stay creative, stay lovely, Juli rocks, signing out. Peace.
Okay, so this is what they look like when they're all dried. I'm really loving the turmeric, the red cabbage, and the beets. And I know this isn't exactly a red color, but I almost have three primaries, so who knows, maybe I could play around with that. The paprika was kind of disappointing just because, I mean, like, even while it was drying on the coffee filter, it stained the coffee filter. So I thought, even though there's gonna be some paprika chunks in it, it's still gonna be vibrant, but obviously you could barely see it. The turmeric I'm surprised by. I was not expecting it to be this vibrant, but I am loving it. I really like how it turned out. Strawberry, I was disappointed with. The same with the black currant, just because the pigment was so dark I really thought that it would be more vibrant. It's sort of like a grayish purple color. I'm not sure if it's catching that on camera, but I was hoping for a deeper purple, so that could have gone a lot better. But the beets, like, this is really nice. I really like these two, especially this. Yeah, this blue's nice, and then the cabbage plus the lemon gives us a slightly different blue color. It looks a little bit warmer compared to this one here. But yeah, overall, I'm excited to test out these colors. So if you're interested to see how they work within an art piece, then tune in next week, because I'll have a video up of that next week. I didn't want to add it to this one just because this video is starting to get a little bit too long. If you have any other DIY art related projects that you recommend, then please let me know in the comments. I would love to hear about them. I think my next one will be creating alcohol inks using Sharpies or like Bic markers. So I have some jars, some glass eyedropper jars that are coming in the mail from AliExpress. So I'm planning to put them in those. So once they arrive, I'll pick myself up a pack of Sharpies and we could play around with that too. I think it's really fun to just create your own art supplies, because I feel like it's not really something that people think about. It's just not really an option, but I mean, creating paints and other materials, it all had to start somewhere, in someone's kitchen or someone's garage back in the day. So yeah, why not play around with it and see what we come up with. Anyways, it is 11:45 on a Tuesday night. I have work tomorrow, so I'm gonna go sleep. But I'll see you guys next week, and thank you so much for watching. Peace.